Welcome to the Aftershock Show, everyone. My name is Alex Morgan. I am your host tonight. We are here to talk about San Jose's 1-1 draw with the Portland Timbers in Portland. They extend their undefeated streak to 6 games now. And then also lots of news behind the scenes before the game. It's reported by Stephen Goff of the Washington Post and in The Athletic as well by Paul Tenorio, that the Quakes sign Jeremy Ebobisse on a huge trade, something like $1.2 million in GAM. We'll talk about all that and more. I've got an excellent crew here tonight. Colin Etnayer from the Aftershock, Asher Kohn from Quakes Epicenter, Jamon Moore as well. And first, I want to throw it to Jamon Moore, who is live at Providence Park in Portland. Jamon, what were your thoughts on tonight's game? It's got to be a pretty rowdy one in Portland tonight.
You know, as almost quiet as it was in the press box in Seattle, because you're enclosed in glass in this NFL-sized stadium, despite all the chaos you can see happening in the stadium. Colin, as you know, that's not the case here. It's wide open. It's 90 degrees outside. It's hot. It's humid. It was probably close to 100 on the field at game time. And it was a crazy night. And yes, the news hitting before the game just seemed to make it crazier. I think the word got around the stadium. I think the fans knew about it. I think a lot of them are not happy about it from a Portland perspective. Quakes fans sound elated. Seems like a really good deal. But man, you know, what a night here at Providence Park, you know, for the Quakes to eke out a draw, I'm going to say, just because of the way the second half went. But in the first half, they played a bit of protagonist soccer, and it was pretty good, but certainly, you know, they had to dig in a bit in the second half as it got a little bit messy.
Asher, your thoughts on the match?
Yeah, it'll be an interesting time for Jeremy Ebobisse to come to practice tomorrow and try and sort out which side he was in that whole fight at the end of things. But yeah, it was an exciting match for something that, again, as Jamon said, they kind of San Jose seeded being the protagonist for a bit, but they still really held their ground, and they had some really interesting ways to try and counterattack and make it interesting, even as they were doing that.
And what a perfect match, by the way, to exhibit the need for a true number nine, which, by the way, you know, we'll find out whether or not Jeremy Ebobisse is genuinely a number nine. I think that most people kind of would argue that he needs to be in that role rather than a winger role. But the Quakes, you know, they start with Cade Cowell, who obviously kind of plays more of a wide forward, Chofis and Espinosa up there. They actually look pretty good doing it. And it seems like that's found some ground, but it's not something that is allowing them to stay on the front foot throughout games. And I think particularly when they're pinned back, it'd be nice to have a focal point of attack. But look, they fought hard in this game. They asserted themselves. Matias, to his, you know, as is his custom, put on attackers in favor of rather than defenders as the game drew on. There's not a lot of coaches in this league who are going to put on attackers to chase a game when it's a draw on the road against an opponent they've never won in that building before. Matias, you know, is still wanted to take control of the team's destiny and put it on his own attackers. So I don't know. It's an exciting game. This is the Quakes under Almeyda have consistently been entertaining and interesting, and they're, you know, when they're at least competent, then it's actually a pleasure. So yeah, it's been a pleasure to watch them continue to fight and scrap, even if they don't quite have the best horses in the race.
But this does feel like a Quakes team that knows what they're doing, that knows what the game plan is to win. They're sitting deeper and they're launching on the counterattack. And look, I've been gone the last 3 games. I've been on vacation. I leave and they have one of the longest winless streaks in Major League Soccer. They went 11 to 12 games without a win. I come back, and now they actually have one of the longest undefeated streaks in Major League Soccer. It's extended to 6 games now because they've had a bunch of draws, and last week that win over the Seattle Sounders. And finally, it feels like they might be turning the tide and picking up some momentum. They're a team that runs very hot and very cold. But, you know, with Nathan coming in and anchoring that back line, he looked good again tonight. With Chofis kind of finding his groove, that's another goal for him. It feels like they're picking up the pace and they're finding their groove. And potentially, Jeremy Ebobisse could be a guy that comes in and takes this team to another level. So, Colin Etnayer, I want to throw it to you with your thoughts on this trade, both from sort of a salary perspective, how it's working, how the Quakes are getting all this gam in order to sign Ebobisse, and what it means for the team and how he could fit in on the field. Take it away. And I believe you're muted there, Colin. I think you have to unmute for a sec.
Oh, man. This is bad. Poor form on my part. Well, I got to thank you, and I got to thank Jamon for getting me up here. It's 1 a.m. I just moved to New York 2 days ago, and here I am on the Aftershock. And the reason why is because this is exactly the kind of thing I live for, is this Ebobisse transaction. So, as you said, Paul Tenorio is reporting it. Stephen Goff's reporting it. Those guys have rock-solid sources, and I think we have literally no reason to believe that it isn't true. Tenorio has it at just under 1.2 million in GAM for Ebobisse, who by all accounts certainly wanted out of Portland, didn't think that it was a good situation for him. And Portland, it seems like we're getting a little bit squeezed on the salary cap. So they get 1.2 million in GAM. They get the cap relief of his salary, which, by the way, the guaranteed portion of his salary is about $700,000 this year. So that those are both big, chunky numbers. And it is important to remember that Garber Bucks are not all dollars are created equal. Garber Bucks are the most valuable kind of dollars in MLS because you can use them for anything. You can use them for a transfer fee. You can use them to buy extra salary space on the cap. You can use them in the trades, as you saw today. You can't use TAM in trades anymore. You can't trade cap space. And you can apply it to any person on the roster. So GAM is the most valuable type of dollar there is. So 1.2 million is a lot. It's one of the bigger transactions that we've actually ever seen in MLS at that level. But what you're getting is you're getting a 24-year-old who's definitely got still room to prove and prove himself and grow into himself as a player, who hasn't been in a good situation in terms of his positions and his tactics. And you're hoping that you're going to be able to unlock that. He's very athletic. He definitely could be a number nine. And, you know, I'm interested to see how he grow and how, if he grows truly into that role in San Jose, if the Almeyda system suits him. But it's a big swing and it's a huge need for the club. They get this guy who's a domestic player. He's got USMNT caps. If he comes off as a number nine, this is a huge get. One other thing I want to note just about the salaries and the GAM. First of all, I didn't even realize the Quakes had that much GAM, and I track these things relatively closely. So I think it's possible, first of all, that one, incentives are built into the package, so it's not necessarily a 1.2 million guaranteed. Two, it could be that that GAM is stretched over multiple years because GAM is actually allocated every single year. So it's possible it will actually be a portion of this year's GAM and a portion of next year's GAM. And the last thing is, because his salary is $700,000, that actually makes him eligible for TAM in the future to get his salary bought below the maximum budget charge, which is important because you can only use TAM on certain players. And the more players you have on the roster to be able to do that, the more flexibility it gives you about how you manage where your cap hit goes. This is exactly what we saw with Chofis and Nathan in the way that the team kind of navigated those salaries, is if they're above the maximum threshold, that's actually better from an accounting perspective. So look, all the things are lined up here where if Ebobisse gets into a better situation, none of that will cost. That cost will seem like nothing. On the other hand, it's a lot to give up. So, you know, and by the way, and Jamon, perhaps I can tee you up by saying this, the advanced metrics are not in love with Jeremy Ebobisse. He's not someone who's been massively productive before. So the thesis is that he's been in the wrong situation rather than a proven track record. But anyway, I'll hand it over to Jamon and see if I got that one right.
Well, I think the one thing to probably to add on top of that, Colin, is that he just signed a multi-year extension in February 2020. So that is a decent indication the Quakes get him at least for another full season, if not longer. Matias Almeyda looks like he's joining us.
With us tonight.
We're going to toss it over to him.
1-1 draw against Portland. We are joined by Matias Almeyda. We'll start by taking a few questions in English, followed by a couple more in Spanish with no translation. Let's get started with a question from Jamon Moore.
Unmuted.
Hi, Coach. Congratulations on the result tonight. A very tough atmosphere. There was a lot of fight, a lot of things going on at the end of the game, extracurricular activities. Your team has now gotten results in several straight games. Are you pleased with the outcome tonight, or do you feel, you know, you're never happy with a draw? Where do you sit being able to come into Portland and take a point tonight? Thank you.
Muted.
Por el punto. Hubo muchas cosas que pasaron en el partido, muchas peleas, especialmente cuando se terminó el partido. Un ambiente complicado. ¿Cómo te sentís con el empate? Si estás contento con el resultado o si nunca te vas contento por un empate.
Primero quiero agradecerle a los jugadores la entrega que tuvieron.
Firstly, I wanted to thank the players for the devotion that they had.
Nosotros hemos cambiado bastante, hemos mejorado mucho.
We've changed quite a bit. We've improved a lot.
Pero creo que el empate llegó pasado el tiempo.
But I think the tie came once time was up.
Pero bueno, no es un justificativo. Creo que hicimos un gran partido ante un gran rival.
It's not a justification. I think we played a great game against a great opponent.
Una cancha que no es fácil jugar.
A field where it's not easy to play.
Bueno, estamos demostrando ese carácter que hemos pretendido siempre.
And we're showing that character that we've always looked for.
Y realmente el equipo así es muy competitivo.
And like this, the team is really competitive.
Thank you, Matias. Next question comes from Alex Morgan.
Hi, Matias. It's good to see you again. Thank you for joining us tonight.
Thank you.
Before the game, the news broke that you guys have signed Jeremy Ebobisse from Portland. You know, can you talk about how that deal might have come together over the last couple days, and you know what a player like Ebobisse could add to the San Jose Earthquakes?
El partido salió una noticia de que San Jose contrató a Ebobisse. Si puedes hablar de los últimos días de cómo se llegó a ese acuerdo y qué un jugador como Ebobisse trae al equipo.
Bueno, estamos hablando de un jugador importante, un joven con mucho futuro.
We're speaking about an important player, a youngster with a big future.
Pero por ahora no hay nada concreto, así que prefiero hablar el día que se concrete.
But for now there's nothing concrete, so I'd rather speak if it comes to be.
Thank you. Marco, do you have a question? All right, let's go back to Jamon Moore.
Hi, Coach. Sorry,
unmuted.
Can you hear me now? Hi, Coach. Thank you for taking another question and taking the time to join us tonight. You get to face LAFC this weekend. Always a very tough opponent. They seem to be struggling a bit right now, lost to Sporting Kansas City tonight. But what is it that you want to take the most? What is it you saw in your team that you want to make sure that you bring against an opponent like LAFC this weekend? Thank you.
Un partido contra Los Ángeles Fútbol Club, siempre un rival muy difícil. Parece que ahora Los Ángeles está costando un poquito. Esta noche perdieron 4-1 con Kansas. Si hay algo que viste en el equipo hoy que querés que tengan contra Los Ángeles.
Bueno, siempre a cada rival que enfrentamos para nosotros es difícil.
Every opponent that we're up against is difficult.
De hecho, los rivales que estamos enfrentando son los que están arriba nuestro.
And in fact, the teams that we're up against are the teams that are above us.
Los Ángeles Fútbol Club es un equipo que nos ha ganado muchas veces.
LAFC are a team that's beaten us many times.
Y nosotros no podemos mirar a ver qué hicieron ellos, sino pensar en qué vamos a hacer nosotros en contra de ellos.
We can't look at what they've been doing. We have to see what we can do against them.
Thank you, Matias. We'll take one more question in English from Alex Morgan.
Matias, tonight Chofis got another goal. You know, he's been contributing a lot going forward recently, and it feels like he's sort of gaining momentum. but then you also substitute him at halftime for Jackson Yueill. You know, can you talk about Chofis's performances recently and maybe why you were thinking about substituting him at halftime in that moment?
Los últimos metió con Chofis en los últimos partidos, se siente como que Chofis está creciendo y sigue aportando goles o asistencias. Si puedes hablar y en el entretiempo lo sacaste, si puedes hablar un poco de por qué decidiste sacarlo en el entretiempo para Jackson.
Sí, lo de Chofis me pone muy feliz.
Chofis' situation makes me really happy.
Lo veo muy comprometido con San José.
I see that he's really committed with San Jose.
Él antes de llegar a San José estuvo un año y medio sin jugar un partido de fútbol.
Before he got to San Jose, he was a year and a half without playing a match.
Para un futbolista de muchísimo tiempo.
And for a footballer, that's a really long time.
Se ha adaptado muy bien a la liga.
He's adapted to the league really well.
Y partido tras partido va creciendo.
Game after game, he's growing.
El motivo por el cual lo saqué fue porque tiene una molestia, si no, no lo hubiese sacado.
The reason that I took him off was because he had a small injury that otherwise I wouldn't have taken him off.
Y bueno, esperemos recuperarlo para el partido siguiente.
And we hope to recover him for the next match.
Thank you. Now we're switching over to the Spanish portion and we will take two questions from Carlos Ramirez.
Matías, ¿cómo te va? Feliz noche, Carlos Mauricio Ramírez de Telemundo. Un abrazo.
Un abrazo, Carlos.
Matías, quiero ir al gol. La pelota que recupera Chofis en la mitad de la cancha, 14 pases consecutivos, un minuto de tenencia y la termina el que la empieza. Circulación por toda la cancha. Teníamos rato que no veíamos un gol donde todo el equipo se veía plasmando lo que hemos visto que entrena el equipo. Cuando un gol de esa naturaleza se gesta, ¿qué te genera? ¿Y cómo viste esa maniobra?
No, me genera mucha felicidad por ellos y por nosotros. Creo que la intención nuestra es que todos corran y que todos jueguen. Bueno, en ese gol está reflejado lo que pretendemos y lo que deseamos que cada jugador de San José se siente identificado con ese estilo. Y siempre es un premio eso. Creo que hemos hecho otras acciones por intermedio del control del juego, pero nos faltó esa definición que por ahí hoy nos hubiese permitido ganar el partido.
Y hablando justamente de la dinámica del partido, Matías, y con respecto a la ocupación de los espacios, ¿cuán conforme estás con el nuevo diseño, ya con varios, 5 o 6 partidos, con la nueva estructura táctica? ¿Cuán conforme estás con la forma en que este módulo ocupa espacio, sobre todo en faceta de recuperación, que antes parecía un problema en el 4-2-3-1 con la longitud de tu equipo?
Bueno, creo que esto no ha hecho más que enseñarme a mí. Creo que he reflexionado después de muchas derrotas, de ver cómo estaban los jugadores. Y bueno, es una alternativa más que tenemos y creo que es un crecimiento para mí como entrenador y a nuestro cuerpo técnico de saber que ya podemos contar con otro sistema más bien entrenado. Entonces eso es crecimiento, lo tomo de ese lugar.
Gracias, Matías.
Un abrazo.
All right, thank you very much, Matías and Augustine.
Learned a lot with those questions.
Apologies, I just heard that we're going to be having Jackson Yueill here soon, we'll have a chance to talk to him. So Alex, I'll turn it back over to you. There's a lot going on at the moment here.
Yes, well, we just heard from Matias Almeyda about a bunch of different topics. First of all, he sort of demurred about the Ebobisse trade. He said that he is a promising young player with a bright future, but that nothing was concrete just yet. We have every reason to believe that the reporting from Paul Tenorio and Stephen Goff is accurate and that this is basically a done deal, but Almeyda is withholding his comments until the Quakes announce it. We also heard from Almeyda that Chofis picked up an injury. That is the reason why he was subbed at halftime. That is a cause for concern, I think, for the Quakes, because, you know, they've already have Eric Rometty on the injury list back there. You know, Jackson Yueill is still returning from Gold Cup duty, so he might not be 100% ready to jump back in the starting lineup. And we know the midfield has been a point where they're lacking some depth. So those are some causes for concern for the Quakes. But Almeyda also sounded optimistic, I think, about the direction this team is headed. And I want to jump back into more talk about the Ebobisse deal, because I think that is a huge positive for the Quakes. And it feels like it really could be a win-win-win situation. Everybody's a winner here. Ebobisse is going to a place where, you know, he will be most likely the main guy. He won't be shuffled out wide where he's been playing for Portland. He wants to be playing up top in the number nine. He should get that role for the Quakes. They need a number nine to come in with some aerial prowess and improve this team. So it's a win for Ebobisse. It's a win for Portland in that they're getting a metric ton of GAM out of this deal. GAM that they can use in a ton of different ways. And, you know, listening to the Portland reporters, Portland fans talk about this, it's simply too much GAM for them to pass up for a guy that's sort of been played out of position for them. You know, this is the amount of GAM that you spend on somebody who you're going to build your team around. And that looks like it's what the Quakes are going to do. He's a young player who is going to add a lot to this team going forward. And, you know, Jamon, you were speaking about it before Almeyda's press conference. You know, you had said this is a trade that you were thinking about that might make sense for the Quakes a couple weeks ago, a couple days ago, before it even happened. So what to you makes this a good profile player for the Quakes, makes this a good deal for them?
Well, I think it's a number of things. First off, the reason that I had Ebobisse in my mind was it felt like the type of trade that if, you know, Jesse Firinelli was not going to make, but if you gave the reins over to Chris Leach and he had his way and he was sitting on a bunch of GAM that he needed to use and he needed to go out and get a nine, literally the first person who came to mind was Jeremy Ebobisse. He's tall. He kind of fit. He's a pressing type player. He wants to play a nine. He doesn't get to play a nine with the Timbers. And, you know, it became pretty known, actually, within MLS circles, talking with some of my contacts around the league tonight, that he's been shopped around. The Timbers wanted to see him go to Europe. And I think they had a problem trying to get him to Europe as a nine. This is a key part of his career. He needs to be successful in San Jose. He's incredibly motivated. He's a leader. He's one of the players that speak out in the Black Players for Change movement. That's an organization that's a part of the MLS players now. You know, he's someone who's not afraid to speak his mind. He's been a great fit here in Portland. The fans love him here. I have a good idea. He's going to be a great fit in San Jose, and the fans are going to love him. Not only that, he's kind of insurance as to whether you keep Almeyda or you don't keep Almeyda, because I believe either way, he's going to be a valuable player for the San Jose Earthquakes over the next couple of years. You got a couple of years left on the deal. Honestly, if you got the GAM to spend and you're Chris Leach and you're sitting there with this GAM, you might as well use it. And you know, I just couldn't think of a better situation that was realistic to happen to me than Jeremy Ebobisse. So everyone seems very bullish on this deal for the Quakes, and I have to agree. They need the height. They need the speed up top. They need a player who can finish balls off. You know, they've had a lot of struggles in the nine, playing, you know, Cade Cowell, who I think they feel like they're playing out of position when they've had to put him there. You've now experimented with Chofi starting there, and you know, a bit. You know, there's a lot of questions. Andy Rios isn't performing. You know, Chris Wondolowski, you know, is in the twilight of his career, probably his last season. So, you know, it just feels like this was something that you didn't want to see the Quakes put off till the offseason. And now you can come to the offseason with kind of a different set of priorities, right? Because you got the center back that you needed in Nathan. He's been, you know, absolutely lights out for this team. Jeremy Ebobisse, we hope we'll see really kind of take over this number nine role and put the goals in that you want to see from that particular position. And so now you can think differently about this offseason without having that whole Chris Wondolowski nine situation kind of sitting over you. I think it's a real big breath of fresh air for the team.
Absolutely. I think it's a really big breath of fresh air. And it's, you know, I think the question for the past couple of years is what happens after Wondolowski? How do they fill this role? And this is the answer. And as you both said, I don't think you could find a better answer than young, domestic, very smart, hyper-athletic, guy willing to do the dirty work. It's something that it seemed like the team was trying to shoehorn Danny Huson into that role for a few years and just never really fit. And they've been now just trying to kind of make up for it this entire season. And it's kind of working, kind of not. But it's great to see the team make a commitment for someone who is still young, still has plenty of room to grow, and isn't this key part of his career that he can then use San Jose as a launching pad for Europe or just dominate MLS for the next decade or whatever his career brings. It'll be great to see. Here's Jackson.
Joining us tonight. It's been a big past couple of weeks from you. You come back from the Gold Cup that you just won with the men's national team, and you get thrown right back in to this game at halftime as a sub. You know, what was the message from Almeyda to you coming on into that game, and you know, what do you take away from a draw like this?
It's been a while. It's nice to be back with the team and with the group, and nice to be playing again with everyone. And when I came in, he just told me to do what I normally do and get comfortable again and get familiar with the team and try to bring some energy and some calmness to the game and just go out there and play and get reacquainted with everyone. So it was fun to be back with everyone, and I think the tie on the road is a good point.
Thank you, Jackson. This question comes from Anthony Passarelli. He asks, how was your experience at the Gold Cup, and how proud are you of the Quakes' performance while you were away?
Yeah, the experience is unbelievable. It's especially winning. It was so cool to be with that group. We came off the Nations League win, which was really special, and then this one is just special or more because of the way we did it and the length of the tournament and how cool and how much it meant to everyone there at the Gold Cup. So I had a lot of great memories from the camp, a lot of good experiences, and happy to come away with the trophy at the end. Watching and supporting from afar was difficult because I obviously wanted to be with the team and with the guys. But they did fantastic. Had some couple hard road games that they fought really well and showed a lot of bravery and heart. And I think that's important. I think the team is getting stronger, and you definitely see that from afar. And then being here today, you see the fight and the desire to get back up in the standings is there, and it's really impressive to see from the team.
Thank you. Next question from Jamon Moore.
Unmuted.
Hey, Jackson. Congratulations, first off, on the Gold Cup trophy to add to your Nations League trophy. I'm sure it's been a very fulfilling summer for you so far, but now you're back here, with the Quakes, at least until World Cup qualifiers for sure. And the team must look to you or feel to you a good bit different. Now they've got the center back Nathan, who's come in. He seems to have solidified the back line. Every game he started, the Quakes have gotten points in. From a distance, and what you've seen about some of the changes Matias Almeyda has made with different formations, as well as bringing Nathan in, and now some heavy rumors of a new attacking threat that's going to be joining the team soon. Does this feel almost like a different team in some ways to you, or did you just fit right back in and it feels like the old Quakes?
I think the addition of Nathan is really good. He's brings great energy to the team. He's got a really good size, his tackling, helps everyone around him. And we always love, players who love to compete and who are aggressive and have a certain passion for the game. And I think he fits that really well. And so he was able to, give the team a boost when we were feeling down. And so you can definitely see that his presence on the field, helping everyone get to how they were in the past and start trying to build on the points and the momentum watching the group and his performances from a distance was really awesome to see, and his presence on the field I think will help us a lot in the future games to come.
Thank you, Jackson. Next question comes from Carlos Ramirez.
Hi, Jackson Curls from NBC Sports Bay Area and Telemundo. How are you?
Good. How are you? Thank you.
Good. Congrats on Gold Cup. What's the main difference on your perspective from the 4-2-3-1 to this new sort of 3-4-3 variable 5-3-2 that the team's deploying right now, or 4-5-2-3? From your perspective, how does it change your game? How can you affect it better on this new scheme with three center backs?
Yeah, I think, you know, with the addition of Nathan back there, you know, we're playing with three center backs who were all good with their feet and you know, can challenge the ball well and can, you know, each have their strengths. And I think, you know, they all complement each other. And, you know, you can tell that we aren't giving away as many chances as we have in the past. And, you know, there's a little bit more order to how we're going about the games. And I think that's important for the whole team and the structure and the flow of the game. So I'm excited to be back here with the team and hopefully I can, you know, step in and help the team keep doing well and start getting some wins.
Thank you, Jackson. We're going to take two more questions, starting with Marko Yufilovic.
Hey, Jackson. Once again, congratulations on the Gold Cup victory. You've been away, seems like, for so long from the Earthquakes with your national team duties. Did you miss this team and your teammates for these last like couple months or so? And also for about the game, do you feel like you guys maybe missed an opportunity there toward the end with the second yellow card there, and you guys had a chance to maybe get three instead of 1 point tonight?
Yeah, you know, this is such a great group. You know, I miss them almost every day. You know, just the being around them is fun, and it really is a family. And so, of course, I was happy being with the national team, and I was focused on being there and doing well. But you know, it's a special group, and you know, from a distance, it's fun watching them do well and have fun, and I'm happy to be back. So definitely miss them. And yeah, you know, I think the red card came late in the game. You know, there's a lot of, you know, breaks from that moment until the end of the whistle, which is to be expected. And, you know, I think maybe we tried pushing and getting a goal at the end, but unfortunately it didn't come. But I think, you know, the point on the road, it's another building step, and we keep getting better and better. And now it's time to, you know, try to put some wins in at home.
Thank you. Last question. This one comes from Ted Ramey. He says the last time San Jose earned a point in Portland was way back in 2014. What makes this venue so difficult for visiting teams?
I think, you know, just the history and the culture of Portland gives them such a boost, you know. And, you know, I think they do well against every team here. It's a tough place to play. You know, the crowd is very involved in the game, and I think it gives you know, the home side a little bit of an edge. And yeah, you know, and they have amazing players. You know, I think, you know, Valeri and Blanco and Chara have been here for such a long time and are still really, really good players throughout the league, and they're a very good team. And so you know, the point on the road is important, and trying to keep moving forward.
All right, Jackson, thank you very much, and thanks for taking the time to speak with the group.
Yep, thank you, guys.
All right. Thank you guys very much. That's it for tonight. We will.
Okay. So that's the end of the press conference for tonight. Asher, jump in here. What did you think of the comments from Jackson Yueill?
It was interesting. I liked Carlos's question about the 4-3-2-1 versus the mix of other things. It was interesting to see kind of in the buildup at the end of the game, or I should really say a second half. It was the only time I've seen this season where Marcin Kaus is just getting the ball along. He was trying to get a 1-1 between Cowell and Mabiala for the entire second half. And they kept on doing a lot of different things in order to try and get that going. And it was, you know, at first it was really frustrating to watch, but it's kind of interesting to see like how Almeyda does stuff that it doesn't at first seem to have a purpose. And then you start to see some of these isolations work. And they were really, you know, the momentum was towards Portland for the first like 15, 20 minutes there. But, San Jose was really dominating that bit at the end, and this is the first time in a while when we weren't complaining about too much added time at the end of the game. So it was kind of fun to watch that.
And it does feel like the sort of tactical and mental evolution of this team has sort of come to fruition at this point, in that the Quakes are now definitively, I think, a team that sits deep and counterattacks. At the beginning of the year, I think that they were trying to be a team that was the protagonist, that was pressing really high, and that was putting themselves on the front foot. But that just wasn't working. They didn't have the pieces for that. And it feels like now Almeyda has embraced a more defensive approach that sort of utilizes San Jose's pace up top more. And it's been working. It's not always pretty. You know, they've had a lot of stoppage time in these last couple of games, a lot of red cards, but it's working. And I think you have to credit Almeyda for taking that sort of pragmatic step and maybe setting aside some of his principles and in order to help the team succeed in that way. And Jamon, I'm curious what you think, because you were one of the early advocates for some of these changes, going to a more fluid formational system, you know, with more use of the 3-4-3. You get a nice tactical cam there, I think, in Providence Park from the press box. What did you see tonight and how the Quakes set up?
Yeah, one of the things that was kind of interesting in the first half, I felt, was that they brought out the same players, but a different setup. So instead of the 3-4-3 with Chofis up top, right, they went back to Almeyda's kind of tried and true, you know, 4-2-1-3 with Cowell up top and Chofis, you know, back at the 10 and kind of just moved everyone around a little bit. And it's hard to say that it didn't work because, you know, the Quakes, I thought, being on the road in Providence Park, always difficult to put on pressure, created some opportunities, got the goal, and were dangerous at times. And I thought defensively were fairly tidy. And if you're going to give up a goal on the road, the set piece that they gave up is the one that you can walk away going like, okay, the ball bounced their way in that particular situation. And basically, it just deflected off two players and went in. So, you know, if that's going to happen, of course, the Quakes goal came off of a spilled ball too from a goalkeeper. So look, you know, neither team I think can like walk away and go like, you know, they dominated the game. I think both teams held their own for particular stretches of it. The thing that I think is interesting about the Almeyda Quakes, and Alex, you brought up the point, and it's something that I've had in my mind. I'd like to write about, I think, a bit more for Quakes Epicenter, is really this idea of changing from kind of protagonists to being pragmatists. I think that's the right way to say it. Asher would correct me because he's the English guy here. And so to me, like, that's a big, huge switch. And I feel like bringing in someone like Jeremy Ebobisse could actually make this come a little bit more to fruition. If you remember, the Portland Timbers were pretty much a counterattacking team when they've been successful over the last 3-4 seasons. Their best success has come as a counterattacking team, and in no small part to some of the efforts of Jeremy Ebobisse through that stretch. So, you know, it is it does feel like it's a situation that could actually, you know, work pretty well for him to come in. The one thing that gives me just a little bit of pause is I do need to see the Quakes putting a little bit better quality shots on frame. It's okay to be outshot, but particularly when you're on the road, they have to be high quality shots. That's something that I'm watching really closely. I think I'll save it for the article. But so far, they haven't really fully made the switch into a team that I think can counterattack and consistently get 3 points. We can see, you know, because of a little bit better defensive solidity in the back, thanks to Nathan and Beeson, I think, getting in there every game as well. I mean, he's growing and he's getting better and came up with a couple key plays tonight. And he's not perfect. He certainly makes his share of mistakes, but he's getting better. And I think he's definitely, along with Nathan, the center backs for the future for this team. And so you kind of got the spine starting to figure out. Now you need to really, I think, begin to build on that and figure out how to make this team successful as a counterattacking team. And is Matias Almeyda the coach for that? You know, it's going to be a question, I think, for the GM if this is an identity that they want to embrace.
It's interesting you bring up the Timbers counterattacking style and Ebobisse is something that I mentioned before on the Quakes Epicenter Patreon Slack account, which is something that if you want to get today's Aftershock 3 weeks ago, you should like subscribe and go for that. But reminds me of when Caleb Porter came into the league a few years back, and he came in from Akron with a very attacking, dramatic, protagonist sort of style of soccer. And it took him until year three to just realize, okay, I can't do this day in, day out, week in, week out in MLS. We need to be a little bit more pragmatic. It's really when Portland went from being a solid playoff team to kind of the league dominant team they've been years, and the Sever race has really taken as well. So it's interesting seeing Almeyda make that some. It'll be interesting also, he's made this decision, this shift, when Jackson Yueill has been out. Jackson Yueill as the number six for this team, he hasn't had to play in that style yet, and he hasn't played with Nathan yet. So I think that it's really great to see this defensive solidity. And it'll be really interesting to see what happens when they have this stretch of home games and Jackson Yueill back with the team, and to see how they're going to build off of that going for the rest of the season.
Absolutely, Asher. I think those are great points there. And I mean, one of the things that was just stood out to me a lot tonight, you talk about this change, is man marking, because it really didn't feel like the Quakes were man marking across that back line. They were basically zonal marking. I think Alanis might have been man marking up top, but that's about it. I do now want to turn to the comments section for some questions. We have a question from Diane directed to Jamon about what he saw in that scuffle towards the end. We didn't get the full picture, Jamon, on the television. So what you could glean, what you could see from the press box, what the heck was going on in that scuffle in the penalty area and all the sort of furor that happened after the red card?
So I have to admit, in all the rush, I had to pick up and move. So I was sitting down where I could see the game, and they asked me to come up here to do the post game because other people are working in this space here. And unfortunately, I didn't get to spend a lot of time watching the scuffle because I was dragging equipment around. But what I did see is Matias Almeyda getting in there and kind of pushing his team back collectively to kind of get them out of there to try to reduce the number of like yellow cards or even post-game red cards that they could get. He's going to need these players. And so it felt to me, at least what I saw, that he was trying to just get his players separated and going. I'm not quite sure what fully set it off at the end, but I think there was a lot of hurt feelings about the red card. And you know, everything kind of carried over. It was definitely messy toward the end of the game. I think they said 5 minutes added on. It felt at least like 10. It might have been even more. I didn't even keep track because things did get so crazy.
I do think that's a new role for Almeyda. I don't think he usually is playing the peacemaker in there, Jamon. I think he's usually
and he may not have at first. He may not have at first. I did see a yellow go up, and I think he may have gotten one. But at some point, like, he decided, like, okay, this is enough. You know, we need to make sure that this doesn't get out of control and pushed everyone back.
Well, at least Augustine didn't get sent off this time. I will say that.
Near as we know.
Asher, do you have any thoughts, last thoughts here on this scuffle before I move on to some more questions?
No. Yeah, it was a pretty clear second yellow on Chara. I don't get what the issue was. I don't lip read Portuguese well enough to hear what was said, to figure out what was said to Nathan, so I really can't say more than that. But yeah, I don't get what was going on, but it was clearly, it's been a thing these past few games. Games don't end peacefully. Games don't end at bedtime for the San Jose Earthquakes, it seems.
All right. I do want to close us out fairly shortly. I'm going to wrap around here for final comments from each of you guys. But before we do that, I want to plug the Quakes Epicenter Patreon. We have a Patreon page at Quakes Epicenter where you can get all the behind-the-scenes access from our team. For $2 a month, you can get early access to all our articles. We've had lots of articles over the last couple of weeks about all of the big picture stuff happening with Jesse Fiorinelli being fired, Chris Leach potentially being a candidate to replace him. I'm sure we're going to have more coming about this Jeremy Ebobisse trade. So stay tuned. You also get access to our quarterly Zoom calls with our whole community, with all the Quakes Epicenter contributors. That happens every quarter. We recently had one after Jesse Fiorinelli was fired. It was fantastic to talk to all of you guys face-to-face. For $5 a month, you can also get access to our Slack channel, which was absolutely buzzing tonight, I should say, after the signing of the Ebobisse and after the match. The chat was on fire, so highly recommend. We really appreciate your support. Everything you support goes back into making this show better, about getting our contributors out to cover away games, like Jamon right now in Portland. That is possible because of your support. So gentlemen, I want to bring it back around for your final thoughts on this match. Jamon, you first.
Yep, I think they're ready for me to get out of here. You know, it was a really, I thought, a up and down game. I'm not sure that the Quakes came out and played the game that they were hoping it was going to be coming in. It felt like against Seattle that it was a much more kind of controlled situation. They kind of funneled players into places that they wanted them. They only got dangerous a couple times. Certainly Portland tonight was much more dangerous than what the Quakes faced against Seattle. There were balls that probably you would say should have gone in the back of the net, I guess. You know, most shots aren't really over a 50% chance, but you know, they had plenty of good chances and decided to hit the scoreboard instead. And so you're facing LAFC at home. And you know, no matter what's going on, it's just like the Quakes and Galaxy. No matter how good LAFC is or isn't in a particular year, and they're certainly starting to struggle a little bit right now, they're always good. They're always up for the Quakes. Bob Bradley's a good coach. He knows how to deal with man marking. The Quakes got the better of them in a couple games last season. So now it's going to be interesting kind of how he takes his learnings from those games and comes back and counters them this year. I would expect some interesting pressing, counter-pressing scenarios to come from Bob Bradley this weekend.
Asher, over to you. Your final thoughts on the game and on the Ebobisse signing.
Yeah, it's so this was game 17. We're halfway through the season, and the Quakes are in that big, gooey midsection of the Western Conference where really everything from 4 through 11 is kind of a mix. And it's interesting, it seems really at the point where if the Ebobisse signing goes through and if it works out how the three of us, certainly four, including Colin, are as excited about it, it could be similar to how Nathan's signing was such an incremental improvement and really solidified the back line. This could be the incremental improvement that makes Espinoza one of the league's most dangerous wingers again, gives Chofis a lot more space to do his weird, goofy Chofis magic, and gives Cowell more space to take people on one-on-one. It could really kind of bring all the dominoes down in a really exciting way through the stretch of this season.
Absolutely, Asher. I think this was a really optimistic night for San Jose. You know, you're going into Portland, a place where they haven't gotten a point, I think the stat was, in many years now. And especially after a tough game against Seattle at the weekend, you go into those two fixtures on the road against Portland, on the road against Seattle, to get 4 points out of those two games, I think is a really good sign for this team. Those are four well-earned points. It bodes really well for this team going forward. But then once again, I think the sort of news on the field, what was happening on the field, was eclipsed, outshadowed by what was happening off the field with the signing with Ebobisse. And I think it was sort of surprising out of left field, because the Quakes haven't had many signings like this in Major League Soccer in a long time, since, you know, definitely not in the Jesse Fiorinelli era. It's a really high profile signing, I think. Probably their highest profile addition since Matias Almeyda joined the team back in 2019. And it feels like a sort of statement of intent. And I think that makes sense, actually. I think, you know, Chris Leitch, if he's gunning for the general manager role, this is the way to get it. You go out in your first couple of weeks and you sign a guy like Jeremy Ebobisse, do a huge trade, show that you have the ability to make those things happen. I think at this point, it's going to be a lot harder for the Quakes ownership to pass up on him as a general manager for that general manager role. This feels like he's flexing his muscles. And I think it's a great addition for the Quakes. I mean, he's the kind of guy who's in form. He's been playing for Portland week in, week out, and he could make an immediate impact even as soon as this weekend against LAFC. I think there's a good chance we could see him getting minutes. And I think one of the other things that the fans will be excited about is that maybe this means we don't see a lot more of Andy Rios, right? The Quakes have had a couple guys who are struggling up top, and Ebobisse feels like the kind of signing who can go in there and fix things. I'm seeing a comment here asking about what Almeyda said. Almeyda said that he is a talented young player. I think he kind of hinted that something was happening, but said that it was not confirmed yet, so he didn't want to make official comments just yet. But certainly we'll know more by the time the Quakes play LAFC this weekend. We'll be live with you again. I will be at PayPal Park. We will have our Aftershock crew covering the game after the match, and we hope to see you there. So, gentlemen, on behalf of Jamon Moore, Asher Kohn, Alex Morgan, thank you everyone for joining us, and we will see you next time.
Have a good night.